In our last episode, we have seen that the human being needs two different basic needs. He needs fuel, that is chemistry, and he needs love, which is a spiritual need, which can be only seen and realized by thoughts. That's why in order to answer the question if disease is coming from thoughts, we must know what are the thoughts. And we answered this question, at least superficially, by our last presentation in which we saw that thoughts are the elements that work with spiritual information, that digest spiritual information. But now we need to know exactly where do they come from. And in order to know where do they come from, we must have an absolute foundation in order to have an absolute answer. And the absolute foundation is the human being. His structure, how we are built, is absolute. The function, how we function, is absolute. Our basic needs, we have seen, are absolute for everyone. That gives us 100% security in order to answer the question, where do thoughts come from? Now, the human being is one organism with many organs. Like this tablet is one piece with many components. So is the human being as well. He is just one. He's not two, but he has many organs. Now, in order to be one with many different organs, you need to have a center of control. You need to have a place where all the wires come together, like you have it in the tablet. So that place where all the wires come together is the brain. So there, the whole body is connected together. It's in the cortex of our brain. That's why we look to our brain and we need to know of what is the brain composed. So he has two hemispheres. And these two hemispheres are not connected physically together. That is, if we cut with a knife between them, we don't cut through the cortex, we just cut through the limbic system to the base, so to say, of the brain. But you don't cut through the cortex because they are totally separated from each other. They have no physical connection on cortex level. That's important to know because that shows us why we can do with one hand something, what we cannot do with the other one, and why we have disease on this side and on the other side of the body we don't have. So let's look to the overview of the structure of the brain. So it's a simple structure. On the outer layer, it's the cortex, and there we have the nervous cells, and they give their channels, their cords, so to say, into the body. And since in the cortex the whole physical body is put together, these wires that go into the body put the whole body into motion and control everything from there. The nerves go into the body and find first the limbic system, that's the center of the brain. And when they come out of the center of the brain, they cross each other. So we move our right hand from our left hemisphere, and the right hemisphere governs the left hand. So the cortex starts to function with electrical inputs. And that goes through the nerve into the center and then passes on into the body, wherever it has to do something. But we have here in the limbic system a first feedback if the impulse was according to the body's needs or not. That is our emotions. We feel if that impulse was good or it was not according to our body. We will see that more in depth in the later episodes. So the question now that we have is, where do the thoughts originate? Do they come from the center of the brain, from the limbic system, from the pituitary gland, from the amygdala? Do they come from the cortex? Or do they come from outside? Where do thoughts come from? That's a basic question to give. Because we must know, can the brain think? And in order to answer if the brain can think, we must just look to what it is composed of. Because that will show us what is possible or not. And the brain is composed of chemistry, exactly like the tablet also. Now, we know that chemical reactions can only occur depending on outside factors, can only proceed as intended, designed, because the necessary prerequisites for a reaction are always predetermined by the law in nature. So there is nothing by chance in chemistry. And then the other ability of chemistry is it can absorb, store, and share energy and information. That's the computer. That's what we have when we have our tablets and phones. We can see it, but even a paper, you can write on a paper and it can absorb, store, and share information. But something chemical reactions cannot do. They cannot make feelings. Have you ever hugged your phone, or maybe in the evening you say, oh, my phone or my tablet needs some good feelings, so I have to give him some attention? Did you do that ever? Do you think it feels something if I throw it down? There is no feeling in anything that is chemical. There is no choice, no choosing. They cannot make decision. This tablet can never make a decision of anything. It just follows the commands that I give to it. So can chemical destroy themselves? No. A chemical element can never destroy itself. Can chemical have consciousness? Can they have cognitive abilities? Can they have morals? Not at all. So then the question is, if the brain's composition is chemistry, then we know by sure the brain cannot be the origin of our thoughts. But we can do these things. We can feel. Disease is something that shows us that we can feel. We can also destroy ourselves. I had a patient who told me the story when she talked to her boyfriend and quit the relationship. He jumped during the phone conversation from the 11th level into death. Can this tablet decide to jump off just to get broken? Humans have cognitive abilities. We can analyze and say, oh, this is right, this is good, this is... And we can get angry or can be happy with what happened. That's cognitive abilities. Chemistry doesn't have that. Your tablet doesn't have it. And we can choose a life partner. We can choose our house. We can choose our car. Nothing physical can do that. So where is the ability of man to think? Where do thoughts come from if they don't come from the brain? That's what we need to understand in our next episode.